Okay, let me start. Dear students, dear colleagues, I would like to announce that today we have a great event. So video conference with our guest from Luxembourg. So it's my pleasure to introduce our guest lecturer, Dr. Michele Barbieri. An expert in international investment law and practice of private investment funds. We all, Michele, appreciate greatly that you kindly agreed to deliver online lecture for us. The title of today's lecture is Private Capital Funds, Strategies, Operations, Structures, and Legal Framework. Let me just say a few words of acknowledgement and a little bit more information. The lecture is very important for us because it goes in line with our course on international investment activities. I'd like to admit that the initiative of the meeting today has been supported by the university administration, and our personal gratitude to our rector, Dr. Yegorov. In addition, the lecture complies with the research under the state program, the title of which is Methodological Foundation and Tools for Improving Innovation and Investment Mechanisms for ensuring the socio-economic security of the state in the context of global reconfiguration of foreign economic relations. And a few words for our students and colleagues about our guest, Dr. Barbieri. Dr. Michele Barbieri is currently director in the Capital Markets Department of Intertrust Group in Luxembourg. Previously, he worked for BNP Paribas Real Estate Investment Management, Deloitte, and PricewaterhouseCoopers. Before starting his career in the financial sector in Luxembourg, he was teaching and research fellow of international economic law and European law in Milan at the Bocconi University and at the Milan State University. He participated in projects of research on international investments sponsored by governmental and intergovernmental organizations, including UNCTAD. He is the author of multiple publications on international investments and economic developments, on sovereign wealth funds, on alternative investment funds, and international taxation. He holds, among others, a PhD in international law and economics from Bocconi University, an MBA with major in finance from EDHEC Business School, and Master of Science in International Relations from the Milan State University. Our cooperation with Dr. Barbieri started 13 years ago. He was invited twice by Belarus State Economic University as a visiting professor to deliver lectures for students and master students of the Faculty of International Economic Relations. That was just a few words about the experience of Dr. Barbieri, his expertise. For Michele, I'd like to say that Yulia, my colleague, is also moderator together with me during this lecture and the following discussion. I think that you might remember her from after your visits to Belarus State Economic University. So this was the introductory speech, and I give the floor for Michele to start our lecture that we are anticipating to hear, to listen.
Thanks a lot for the presentation, for having the opportunity to be discussing again, meeting again you and the students of the Belarus State Economic University. It's the first time that we are having this meeting, this discussion remotely. The past, of course, I was there in presence, but it's always a pleasure to have the possibility to meet your students, to discuss about the topics of interest to us. So My colleague, Dr. Petrushkevich, made a very good presentation of myself, a very nice presentation. So I think I really cannot add anything more better. So I would like to move directly to the presentation. So I prepared a few slides that I will share during this presentation. If I correctly understand the format of the conference will be around 40 minutes of a presentation of my slides, and then there will be the remaining part of time, so around the other 40 minutes for question and answer. Perfect. Yeah. Okay, great. So indeed, it's I think it's quite an interesting topic, the one that we are going to discuss today, because private capital funds are really important investors in the current landscape, and they are very important in mobilizing not, I would say, short-term capital, but also long-term investments. So we will see more in detail very shortly. They provide a useful capital for infrastructure, for long-term equity financing or debt financing of companies. So they can be also a very important tool to promote capital deployment and economic growth in the states where they invest. My presentation that I'm going to open now, but I understand that you already had an overview of the slides, will focus on all the main aspects of funds, so their characteristics, their assets, their main structures and operation. I will try to keep as much as possible a more descriptive approach without entering into legal or accounting technicalities, but of course, if you would like to go a bit more in depth of them, we have the second part of the lecture for question and answer, so I will be more than happy to enter into more the details. So let me quickly share my screen so that we can see together the slides that I prepared as a supporting, and then we can start. Okay. So I think that you can all see these slides, correct?
Yes.
Perfect. So we can start. So indeed, the topic of the presentation is this one, and I will quickly spend a very few words to explain the main topics that we will try to address today. So first of all, we should probably provide some introductory definition, and for instance, it's really important to understand what are investment funds, what are investment fund managers, because there can be differences. Then we will clarify which are the main asset classes in which these private investment funds invest. And essentially, we see that the main categories of assets will be private equity, private debt, infrastructure, and real estate. Then we will see which are the main legal forms that are used in these investment funds, and also some structure, because sometimes we will see we don't have the investment fund directly buying or selling assets, but it will be doing this through a complex, more or less complex underlying corporate structure. Then we will see also the role of the fund managers in the managing the funds, and we will see also all of the life cycle, because usually what we think about investment fund is essentially their investment activity, but actually they are a very complex vehicle. They are very complex financial products that have a very long fund life cycle. Then we will discuss a bit about the fund operation, because as I was anticipating, as funds are complex vehicles, complex structures, they also have a complex operation. And actually my current activity, my activity in the last few years in Luxembourg has been mainly on fund operation. So I would say that my field of practical expertise is more of this specific part. And then I will provide a few examples of private equity investment, debt investment, real estate investments, and of the structure that will be that is put in place in relation to them. So first thing, of course, let's define investment funds. So investment funds are essentially investment product. So something, I'm using the most generic term possible, something that is used by investors to perform investment. How and why? So they are collecting money, resources from multiple investors. Then all of this money from multiple investors, different investors, is collected, gathered, centralized at the level of the investment fund. And the investment fund use the money so collected to buy multiple assets. So this is essentially the rationale of investment via an investment fund versus investment directly in an asset. And the main advantages of using an investment fund are indeed the possibility of collecting more resources, because they come not from one investor, but from many investors, and use these resources to invest in a lot of underlying investments in order to diversify, to spread the risk. I mean, you may imagine that, for instance, if I am, let's suppose that I am a very wealthy person, which is not the case, but let's suppose so that I want to, let's say, make an investment in real estate. So what can I do? I can buy a building, but then I'm exposed to the risk of that building, in the sense, let's suppose that I have a tenant who does not pay the rent, that the building needs some unexpected repairs. So I am alone with all the risk connected to this single specific investment. Funds allow to reduce this risk. Why? Because I will put my money together with other 10, 50, 20, 100 people. And then the money that is collected in this way is used to buy not one, but let's suppose 10, 20 buildings. So this means that if one building is an investment that is not performing because I have a tenant that is not paying, it's not just me who is losing, but a little bit all the other investors. But on the other side, we are more compensated all by the good performance of all the other building in the portfolio. So this is really the key, the basic rationale of having an investment funds, putting money from several investors and spreading this money upon several underlying investments, so several assets, to diversify the risk. This is the main advantage of having an investment fund and using and making an investment in an investment fund rather than in a direct single asset. And then also a second big advantage is that investment funds are professionally managed. So probably if I wanted to buy a building on my own, then I need also to make the financial analysis myself and also to manage the building. On the contrary, all of these functions concerning the choice of the proper asset, the management of the assets, is done professionally by the people working from the fund or the fund manager. So this is the key rationale of investment funds. Then there are a lot of different funds. The broader distinction is between funds investing in securities and funds investing in all other assets. Funds investing in securities are funds that we will not cover in detail in this presentation, but of course I need to mention them. They are funds that usually buy listed shares, listed bonds. So in the case of these say public capital funds, the various investors put money in their fund, and with this money the fund buys a lot of different shares, bonds, listed on various stock markets, etc. Then there are also other kind of funds that are those that we will discuss more in detail today, that are the private capital funds. So they invest in assets that are not available on public markets. So this is the key definition of the funds that we are going to study today. So vehicle collecting money from a plurality of investors, spreading this money into a plurality of underlying assets, and these assets are not available on public markets. So this allows us to go a step further and to C, which are the main category, as I was a bit anticipating before, of private equity, of private capital. So first of all, and this is the most important category, they are the private equity. Maybe I was just checking that I can make an image a big, bigger. Yeah, probably it's better for you to see. So indeed, first of all, we have private equity that represent by far the biggest, the most used, the most widespread funds in terms of asset under management. Because here I took the figures provided by the consulting company McKinsey, and we see that the large majority of the assets under management are managed by private equity. Private equity funds essentially invest in equity, so shares essentially of companies that are not listed. So this means that, for instance, there is a company which has not issued shares on listed markets, and this company would like to raise additional capital. Let's suppose, for instance, that, I mean, I do a lot of practical and basic example that, let's suppose that a person has a company, let's suppose I have a company that is producing shoes, nice shoes, nice Italian shoes. I wanted to open new lines, new factories, etc., and I need more capital. I don't have money for my own to add this additional operation. So what I do, I agree with a private equity fund that they will provide me with some equity. They will not give me a loan. They will become a shareholder like me. So let's suppose that I am the owner and the entrepreneur, let's say, of this manufacturer of shoes. I agree with a private equity fund that they will become a shareholder in this company together with me. And in this way, they will provide me with this capital to increase, for instance, the operation, to open new lines of shoes or whatever you may imagine. And of course, then we share the profits, no? So when my company earns more money, then I have to split these profits with the other shareholder, that is this private equity fund. So essentially, the private equity funds are those that collect money from investors, and they use this money to invest in privately held companies. So in my manufacturer of shoes in Italy, or in the manufacturer of hats in Belarus of a friend of mine. So this kind of a transaction. Similar but different from private equity funds, we have also private debt. In this case, what they do, rather than investing via equity, like private equity funds do, they invest in debt. So they provide a loan to a company, to various companies, because we said before that they spread the risk by investing in multiple assets. So in this case, the loans, the assets of this fund will be loans that either are directly originated. So the fund directly lend money to the company, more or less like a bank does, right? So it's not too different. Sometimes the private debt fund, on the contrary, acquire loans that have been granted by someone else, for instance, by a bank, and then they keep it in its portfolio. So if we come back to what we were saying before, so in a case of a private debt fund, again, the investors can be always the same, but the underlying assets are loans to companies. In private equity funds, on the contrary, the multiple assets, the investment consists in equity in non-listed companies. Then other kind of real estate funds that are after private equity are the most important are real estate funds. They invest in building, in immovable properties, etc. And then we have, but they are quite small natural resources and infrastructure. So they invested, you know, in fields or in a copper mining field or things like this. So again, for instance, in a case of real estate funds, investors inject money in the fund and then the fund purchases several buildings. So you see the rationale is the same. The rationale of having the fund is the same. What changes is, of course, the kind of assets, and also based on the kind of assets, also the specific strategy, financial analysis, of course, they change. So now I would develop a bit more the legal form that is used to set up a fund, no? Because for the time being, when I was referring to a fund, I was defining it as a financial product, as a vehicle. But now let's see what the term vehicle that I was using in a very generic way before actually means. So essentially, as you can imagine, every country has its own law. So specific rules change from one country to another. Because of my activity, I'm more especially of Luxembourg law, but we have some exposure also to the law of other countries. But irrespective of all the differences that are the details and are well known by the lawyers of each country, there are some general characteristics, some general legal figures that can be found more or less in all investment funds that we find in the world. First of all, they can be set up as a corporation, as a company. So usually they are governed by the company law of the state of incorporation, plus eventually by specific fund law, again, of this country. So for instance, if we have, like in this case, a private equity fund incorporated in Luxembourg, then if it is incorporated as a company, then this means that it is subject to Luxembourg company law plus to some specific fund regime. They can also be set up as a limited partnership, which is more the case here, and I will explain in detail this very soon. They can be set up as a pool of assets based on contractual arrangement. In this case, they are not companies. They are without legal personality. Or they can also be set up as a trust. Honestly, it's not a kind of structuring that I know well from personal experience, because for instance, in Luxembourg, I don't have any fund set up in this way. Usually the funds with which I had a lot of experience and that I see more widespread in practice are those created as limited partnership. Maybe at this stage it is useful that I provide you with some additional idea about where most funds are based. The biggest fund jurisdiction in the world, I mean, the jurisdiction where most funds are set up and situated and located, are the United States, especially the state of Delaware, Luxembourg, and Cayman Islands. So for a set of tax and, I would say, more legal consideration, these countries are particularly important. So, I mean, we have, for instance, many cases, many funds based on Cayman Island, that, as you can imagine, not a very big country, but they have a specific legal framework. So many funds, especially with non-US investors, are set up in Cayman Island. Many funds with US investors are set up in the US, especially in Delaware. In Luxembourg, we have investment funds that collect capital from investors really from all over the world and invest in many cases, mainly in European assets, but it can be also in other assets. So usually the location of the fund depends on legal and tax consideration, but also on the specific requirements of the investors and also the specific characteristic of the underlying investor. So that's why I think this is quite relevant to be shared, because I am expert of Luxembourg funds. I have some knowledge of Cayman funds, and probably it's legitimate to wonder why it's so relevant to be familiar with funds in Luxembourg, because actually the majority, not the majority, but a relevant part of all the funds collecting money from investors in all the world and investing in all the world are actually based in Luxembourg. So after this small clarification, I would like to focus a bit more with you on exactly this example of fund set up as a partnership. This is the typical structuring that we have in Luxembourg. It's also common also, for instance, for Cayman Island funds. So what is the characteristic of a partnership, limited partnership? It has two categories of partners, a general partner and limited partners. There is a big difference because they are treated in a completely different way according to company law. So the general partner has unlimited liability for the company, but it is the one that can manage the company. Limited partners, on the contrary, they have a limited liability in the sense that if the fund lose money, they can lose only what they have invested, but not more. But in exchange, let's say, for this limited liability, they cannot take investment decision. In general, they cannot manage the fund. So usually we have this kind of structuring to have the general partner that is an entity owned or otherwise controlled by the fund manager, which takes the ultimate decision of what to do as an investment, etc. Investors, on the contrary, are the limited partner. So essentially, the investors want to invest money and they are ready to lose. Of course, they are not willing, but they know that in the worst case scenario, they will lose what they invested, but not more. On the contrary, the general partner has in principle unlimited liability, which means that it can lose more than what it invests. Why? Because the typical characteristic of a partnership is indeed that if, let's say, the fund set up as a limited partnership loses everything and in addition it has some debt, then the creditors cannot ask additional money to limited partners. So limited partners will lose only what invested, but the creditors of the fund cannot ask to the limited partner, okay, you must give me also this additional money that the fund was unable to pay me. On the contrary, the general partner, as it is the one which is managing, is liable with its own capital for additional losses that may be incurred by the private equity fund. So let's just a very basic numerical example to make this clearer. So let's suppose that all limited partners together have invested, say, 100 million euros in the fund. And the GP, 1 million. Usually it invests less, but let's not focus on this point. The fund makes investment also using some, also taking some loan. Then let's suppose it's a really unfortunate scenario, but it's just to make the example clearer. Let's suppose that the investment of the fund lose all their value, and in addition, the fund needs to repay the loan that he got from the bank, then the bank cannot ask this money to limited partners. They just lost what they invested. They will not have anything back from the fund, but they cannot be asked to be responsible from the liability of the fund itself. On the contrary, the general partner can receive the request from external lenders, so the bank in this case, to pay what the fund is not able to pay because it is insolvent. So this is a very typical structuring. So when you have a fund that is set up as a partnership, you will always have a general partner that is the one that manages the fund, and the limited partners that are the investors. So as I was saying before, and probably as you are already seeing now, because you are seeing that the fund is quite a complex structure, of course, it requires a lot of activities. I mean, I repeat, an investment fund is not just about buying and selling assets, trying to gain money this way. This probably is the core activity of the fund, but to to be able to do this, it needs to have a lot of additional ancillary activities before and after this core activity, that is the investment and divestment phase. And first of all, we have to see that, first of all, the fund usually is managed by a fund manager, which is a separate entity, which a specific scope, a specific activity is to manage an investment fund or more investment funds. So in this chart, it's this entity, not the fund manager. Then, in addition to the fund manager, we also have, of course, the fund that we are discussing so far, and also in order to acquire certain assets like a building or non-listed companies, usually the fund needs to set up some intermediary corporate structure. We will describe the detail of this later when I will provide some example, but for the time being, just be aware that there is not just the fund, but there is also the fund manager that manages the fund or several investment funds. And there is also a corporate structure, so I mean a plurality of companies, legal entities, directly or indirectly held by the investment fund, that are used as an intermediary vehicle to perform the acquisition or sale of the assets that are purchased or sold by the fund. So that's why when we consider the investment fund life cycle, we need to consider the life cycle of the fund manager, because to have a fund, first we needed to have a fund manager who is able to manage this fund, and also the fund corporate structure, because indeed after the fund is set up, in most cases it cannot directly buy and sell assets, but it needs to create, to set up certain companies held by it that will be those companies which will finally buy the assets of the fund. So once this is clarified, the main phases of the life cycle of the investor are the setup of the fund manager. So let's suppose that after these classes, we are all willing to, maybe not immediately after this class, but in the future, we want to set up together a fund, make work together to make this kind of business. So the first thing that we should do is to set up a fund manager. So a company that is subject to strict regulations, strict requirements, and which has as its main activity, statutory activity, the management of investment funds. So once we have our fund manager, that is a company, and let's suppose that we are, this is a fancy example, that we are the founders and the employee of this fund manager. What we do next? Okay, we set up the fund. So usually we go to the lawyer, we ask the lawyer to draft a lot of legal documents, the fund prospectus, the memorandum, the limited partnership agreement, so a lot of complex document. And in this way, the fund is created, is incorporated, is set up, etc. Once the fund is ready, and of course, we know whether we will use this fund to buy building or to buy shares in a non-listed company. So let's suppose that we decide to set up a real estate fund. So we have our fund management company. We have our investment fund. We know that we wanted to buy various building, for instance, big offices or shopping mall across Europe. Then we need, and usually we do this work together with our tax advisor and legal advisor, we need to set up the fund corporate structure. So for instance, if we wanted to invest, I don't know, if we wanted to buy a building in Germany from this, let's suppose, Luxembourg fund, then we usually don't have just the fund buying the building. No, the fund usually set up some companies held by the fund, and these underlying companies will ultimately make the acquisition. And then there is a quite complex intragroup financing to ensure that the money goes from the fund to the intermediary structure and then to the building, and then up in a way to also optimize the possible tax charges, etc. So that's why the part setup of the corporate structure is also tax driven. I don't say that the tax is the only motivation to have all these intermediary structure below, but it's quite relevant, quite important. Then, okay, we have the fund is ready. Of course, we have to ensure that we have investors, no? Because as we're saying, the characteristic of an investment fund is that it's not investing its own money. It's collecting money from external investors. And then with this money, it makes the investment. So there is this marketing activity, which actively consists in, especially for private capital funds, is very much relation-based, personal relations-based. So this means that, for instance, in our hypothetical fund manager company, there will be some among you that are maybe particularly good with marketing, that we go around, meet a potential investor, explain the characteristic of the funds, and then the investor will, some of them hopefully will say, okay, we think that you are selling a good product, I think that your strategy is good, that your team, investment team is experienced, so I trust you, so I'm fine to give you my money to invest. So usually the investor enters into a subscription agreement with the investment fund, and with this subscription agreement, they commit, I mean, the investor commit to give money to the fund so that the fund can use this money to perform the investor's investment. So finally, this part is over, and then we can do the investment. So usually the fund manager company that was set up before, they have a team of financial analyst, investment expert. So let's suppose that, again, in the case that we are having this, we are all the employees and the bosses and the founder of this asset manager, fund manager company. There will be among you those that are better with accounting, financial analysis, et cetera, that they will make their analysis, their studies, and they will come out and say, okay, it's a good idea to buy that specific building because we think that it's in an area that will become more expensive, so we can have a capital gain when we sell it, or we can have good tenants, so earn a lot from rents. So the investment team decides or advises which are the investment to be done, and the fund ultimately buys the asset. So now the investment phase is completed. And then, of course, the fund, the characteristic, I would say, of these private capital funds, they are quite long-term investors. So they don't expect to buy a building today and sell it tomorrow, just gaining a small percentage, because you can imagine that buying and selling a building that maybe is worth 200 million euros is a big transaction. So the transaction cost for this can be hundreds of thousands of euros. You have to pay a lot of lawyers, tax advisor, intermediaries. So it's really a costly transaction. So usually the investment is a long-term one. So usually, I don't know, it really depends, but a real estate investment fund, which is the example we are using now, can keep an investment between 5 and 10 years, say. So this means that during these 5 or 10 years, it's key to properly manage the building. To properly manage the investment, the asset means, okay, in the case of a building, first of all, you have to ensure the proper administration of the walls, of the physical part of the building. So to check if repairs are needed, improvements of the building are needed, etc., and then ensure that they are done in the most cost-effective way. But also there is the financial management part, so ensure that there are proper incomes from the tenants, and if it's possible to increase them or not. So it's important that this part is done particularly well. And then at the end of the decided period, there can be a divestment. So in this case, essentially the fund gains money in two ways, in this case of a real estate fund. First of all, the fund can have a capital gain. So let's suppose that they buy a building in an area that is quite cheap at that time. After 7 years, they sell it, and that area is becoming a nicer area, so prices are higher. So maybe they buy the building for 50 million and they sell the building for 60 million. So this, of course, is the first gain of the fund. And secondly, of course, during the life cycle of the investment, the fund is receiving income from this investment. In the case of a building, we are talking about rent. So for 7 years, the building is gaining, the fund is receiving rents and then also capital gain. And then all this money that is received from the underlying investments to the fund is distributed from the fund to the investors. So just coming back again here. So we have during the life cycle of essentially these assets, in our case building, they pay rents to the fund. The fund receives this money and makes periodic distribution of this income to the investors. Then usually when one of these or more of these assets are sold, if there is a capital gain, the investment fund will return to the investor not only the amount that they have invested in the beginning, but also the difference, the capital gain. Of course, the investment fund is not doing this for free. So the business of the fund, or even more precisely of the fund manager, is indeed to take a fee, a commission. So a percentage of what is invested and a percentage of what is gained is going not to the investors, to the LP, but to the fund manager. So this is the way essentially fund managers make money. There are fund managers that are good at managing the funds and they can earn a lot of money. So it's, I mean, in the past it was easier probably. Now there are a lot of fund managers and there is more competition. So it's more difficult for them to charge FT fees and to find exceptional opportunity for return. But indeed, fund manager can be quite a lucrative activity because of this. Okay, now we are arrived to an apparently complex slide. I hope that at least it will be apparently complex after my explanation. But I would say we are leveraging in the explanation of this slide a lot on what we have discussed so far. So, I mean, this slide should be now quite familiar to you in certain parts. So again, we have the fund, the limited partners, the general partner. So limited, the general partner manage the fund, limited partners or investor, they invest in the fund. So usually how does it work in terms of cash flow? So the investors send their money to the investment fund, correct? Then the investment fund, second step, use this money to make the investment. So suppose that it buys a building or shares of a listed company or a loan or a field where they can grow crops. And so the investment is done. So this is the downstream part, you know, of the cash. Then the investment is hopefully bringing good return. So we have income coming from the underlying investment going into the fund, and then the fund will distribute this income on a pro rata basis to the investors. So of course, if there is an investor who invested three times more than the other, of course, it will take three times more of the distribution. So this is in red, the cash flow part and the operation concerning the fund and the investors. We have other entities, other service providers that are necessary for this fund operation. One, we already discussed about it, is the fund manager, which provide fund management services. And these fund management services mainly consist in portfolio management and risk management. Then there are other key service provider. And first of all, I would like to mention the administrator, also because it's the kind of entities where I had spent most of my career in Luxembourg. So essentially they perform a lot of ancillary tasks, but they are absolutely important for the fund to be able to carry out its operation. So without an administrator, there is no one taking care of administering the cash going in and up the fund. It takes the register of the investors. It provides also additional administration, corporate accounting service, because as we were saying, in most cases, the funders set up as companies or partnership. So they are subject to many legal and regulatory requirements, and the administrator usually provides them. So for instance, the fund needs to have accounts prepared every year, plus maybe additional reports to be shared with investors. So the administrator usually is the entity, the company to which the fund outsourced these services. So technically, some of these services can also be made by the fund manager, but usually the fund manager in the life cycle of the fund and in the chain of value, usually the investment manager wants to focus on this part. So marketing, investment, management, and the divestments. The part concerning the administration of the fund and of the fund structure is usually outsourced to administrators. Then another service provider that maybe we can discuss separately in a question and answer later, if you're interested, it can be the depository, which essentially ensure that the assets that are invested, that are bought by the fund, are kept separately by the fund so that they can be used only for the purpose of investing. So now that you have become, I trust, familiar with investment fund, fund manager, investors, etc., we are ready to try to understand how a fund corporate structure is set up to perform investments. As I was saying in the beginning, you rarely have the fund that is directly buying assets. So, of course, in the beginning, I was sharing you this just to explain you the rationale. But I mean, of course, it's correct to say that the investment fund invests in multiple assets. But usually, there is a something in between. And this something consists in intermediary companies that are part of the so-called corporate structure. So usually the investment fund between itself and the final assets in which it invests has this intermediary corporate structure that is needed from tax and legal reason to ensure that the investment can be made in practice. So here you see an example. So here we have the fund. Here we have the final assets, I call invested company. And in the middle, we have something else. So let's see together what is this something else. Usually, the fund that is, in this case, a partnership. So you have to think also that there is a GP and investor here, but I don't focus on this anymore. Just focus on what now is below the fund. So we have the fund. The fund usually holds, so it's a shareholder, 100% shareholder of in holding the company. So it's a fully taxable company limited by shares. And then this holding company can set up various small companies, sub-holding in specific countries, and they will be used to buy the entity that is the company or the shares of the company that represent the final investment. So you see in practice that there is not the fund directly receiving money from investor and directly putting this money into an investment, but usually the fund, once it receives money from limited partners, from investors, downstream somehow this cash, this money, down in the structure, and when the fund goes down in the structure, then there is the actual investment. So, for instance, we can have the fund receiving, let's suppose, let's make an example. So we have Effet among its several investments wants to invest in the Italian company, sorry, the Italian company producing shoes, which is the invested company that we see here. What does it do? It has a holding in Luxembourg. So usually the fund in Luxembourg send money to an holding company in Luxembourg, which send money to a sub-holding in Italy. And then this sub-holding is used to buy and then to hold the company that is the object of an investment. So the rationale for these are essentially, first of all, to segregate different investments. This means that in this way, as all these companies below are limited liability company, if one investment goes very bad, this does not have an impact on the other two investments, for instance, that go in a better way, that performs better. So this is one of the first rationale of having usually one company to perform one single investment, one single acquisition. Second reasoning is for tax structuring, because essentially among all these companies, there are complex intra-group financing instruments, so specific kind of loans, capital injection, etc., that ensure that when money goes from the fund to the target investment, and especially when it goes up, there are very few or little tax leakages. So to avoid that there are, for instance, too many withholding taxes to be paid. So it's really to be done this is, of course, is done to fully ensure respect of the applicable law of all the countries. So the tax law of the countries at issue, plus the tax treaties between these countries, provided that in certain cases, less taxes can be required to be paid when there are these capital movements. So this kind of structure are made usually by tax lawyers who advise which is the best way to set up a structure in a way that is fully compliant with all applicable law, but also to avoid having to pay excess taxation or maybe to have to pay tax twice in different jurisdictions for the same investment. Maybe a last point that I would like to stress. This is a quite simplified structure because, here we are just considering a private equity fund that invests in just three companies. In practice, we can have, 20, 50, 100 investments. So you imagine how complex can be the structure chart of an investment like this. I would say here it's another example of private debt investment funds. Again, both private equity, private debt, they have a huge variety of strategies. These are just an example. In this case, we know that we have, let's focus on the orange part, the private debt fund that usually set up as an intermediary corporate structure, a specific company, a debtco, we call it in this way. And this entity provides a loan to various companies. And essentially, this company then pays an interest on this loan. The interest goes to the debtco. The debtco upstreams money to the fund, and then the fund distributes this income to the investors. Here I wanted to put together a private equity structure here in blue with a private debt structure in orange because it's quite a widespread case, a widespread example of sponsored private debt transaction. What does it mean? That there is a private equity fund, like the one that we have seen just in this case, that, okay, it makes its equity investments. So it buys shares, non-listed shares of various companies. Sometimes it may decide this private equity fund to take also some loan to finance its acquisition. So who can provide the fund with this or the underlying companies with a loan? Of course, a bank. But in some cases, a bank can take too much time, can have too complicated procedure. I mean, there are many kind of consideration. So what we can have? We can have the case in which the managers, the manager of the private equity, they meet the manager of the private debt fund, and they say, okay, we have this investment opportunity. We are buying a very good company in Italy producing shoes. We will be the indirect shareholder of this company, but we would like that someone provide us some additional financing as debt, so as a loan. Are you interested in this business opportunity? And then the investment team at the private debt fund makes all the calculation. They say, okay, it can be a good investment because we can buy a loan to this company that I don't know is worth 20 million, 50 million, and we will receive an interest of, let's say, 6%, 7%, which, for instance, with the current interest rate, for instance, in Europe, is very high. So they will say, okay, and in this way, how do the sponsor private equity fund and the private debt split the game. Simply, when this company in Italy earn money, okay, it pays the workers, the machine, etc., then it has to pay the interest on the loan. So this money goes first of all to the DevCo and then to the Luxembourg private debt fund, which will distribute it to its investors. So let's suppose that it was agreed that this company would have received a loan of, let's say, 20 million with a 10% interest. So when the company receives its revenues, it will use a part of these revenues to pay 10% of 20 million. Then, if after the after having paid all the expenses, included the interest on the loan, the company still has hopefully profits, then it will distribute these profits to the subholding, which will distribute these profits to the holding, which will distribute them to the private equity, which finally will distribute it to investors. Again, you will see that these require many movements of cash across multiple jurisdictions. So that's why it's important that the structure is engineered and administered in the proper way, because otherwise you risk to pay taxes in Italy, then taxes in Luxembourg, then taxes in the country of residence of the investor that can be, I don't know, it can be Germany. So, I mean, if we start having three or four countries imposing taxation on the same investment, then to have an investment via the fund does not make sense anymore, because you lose a lot of money in taxes. On the contrary, the fund is structured in a way to benefit of the applicable rules, national law, double tax treaties, to ensure that there are less tax leakages. And this is achieved, first of all, with this structure, and also to by ensuring that there are certain financing instruments, like, for instance, intra-group loans that ensure that we avoid paying taxes twice or three times on the same transaction. So this is the rationale of having this kind of complex structure. And then last example, but probably it does not need so many explanations because we already made a lot of examples before referring to a case of investment fund. So you see, we can have a real estate investment fund situated in Luxembourg. It sets up an holding company in Luxembourg. And then this company is used to buy building in different countries. Here, okay, I choose as a joke some iconic building of Italy. This one in Italy, for instance, is the historical seat of the Italian Stock Exchange. So far, as far as I know, it's not for sale, but I mean, usually investment funds, real estate funds invest in almost this kind of building. So big building, I mean, they would not invest in a small apartment where I'm living, but they invest in bigger offices, shopping malls, etc. So again, we have the investors, limited partners, that are investing in the fund. Then the fund downstream money to the holding. The holding ensures that this money goes to the Italian company that is called property company, because its sole objective is to buy and hold the company. And then with this money, the Italian property company pays the seller of the building, and then it receives the building. Then this building usually is given, is rented out. So periodically, the Italian property company receives the rent from the tenants, and then it pays upstream this money to the holding to the Luxembourg fund, and the fund pays the investors. So this was a very quick introduction. We tried to cover many topics. On purpose, I didn't go in detail of everything. So I think that we have quite a lot of time for you for question and answer, so that I will be more than happy to answer your question and enter more in detail on all the things that we have quickly seen today. So please, the floor is yours.
So thank you very much, Michele, for a very, very interesting presentation and lecture. I think that you allowed all of us to immerse to the world, let's say, universe of private capital funds. I give a floor for questions from students and from colleagues, from our colleagues. As for the students, maybe anybody wants to ask okay, Denise, please.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Michele, could you tell in general which factors have become the drivers of private capital funds growth?
Okay, yeah, it's a very good question, thanks. Essentially your question is, why these funds are getting particularly useful and their asset under management is growing, because indeed this is the case. So the amount of asset under management is getting bigger and bigger, and there is indeed an economic rationale. So in my view, the main drive is that the world, especially in the last few years, has a lot of liquidity. So also to cope with the current pandemic, before with the economic crisis, etc., central banks have injected, especially the US Central Bank, but also the European Central Bank, the Bank of Japan, they have injected a lot of liquidity in the system. And this more money goes to institutional investors, banks in particular, and they need to do something with this money. And what they do, they buy assets, they make investments. And traditionally, the easiest way to invest was to buy shares, bonds, but then their prices went up a lot. And in case of bonds, the return, the interest was getting lower and lower because of the demand to buy these assets were increasing. And this explained why many investors said, okay, if I invest in shares, listed shares, listed bonds, return are very low and I have to pay a lot for them. So I need something else, a non-liquid asset, which is more difficult to find, more difficult to invest in. And so I, as investor, I have an interest in putting my money in a private capital fund. Of course, I see also from a personal perspective, if I wanted to buy listed shares in a company, I can go on my web banking or my online platform and in 1 minute also, while we are discussing now, I can click and I can buy some shares or some bonds listed on the stock exchange. On the contrary, if I wanted to buy a bridge, a minefield, a building, a shopping mall, then it's a bit more complicated. It's not something that I can do personally with a few clicks from my home. So essentially, the need for alternative investments, I mean, alternative compared to usual stocks and bonds, of course, was a big driver for the increase of importance of a private debt fund, because essentially they are, of course, less liquid, but they provide a higher return. For instance, until 1 year ago, more or less, I was working a lot on a private debt fund. And I was seeing that these funds, they were investing in quite safe companies. So they were not investing in speculative or high risk companies, but they were lending money to companies with a good rating grade, quite solid. But the interest that they were charging and receiving was around, depending on the case, between 8%, let's say 6%, 8%. Now you compare the interest rate that you can have if you buy listed bonds in the European Union, which is maybe 1% or even less. So here you see the advantage. So as an investor that I have quite a long term horizon, I can say, okay, if I directly invest in bonds, I can get 1% return per year. If I make an investment that after all has almost a comparable level of risk, but by private debt, so using a private debt fund, I can have 6% of return. So essentially, this is one of the main drivers, because let's say markets for securities, listed shares, listed assisted bots, they were giving, especially in EU, but also US, a very low return in this current situation. If investors wanted to have some extra point, extra return, they needed to look for other kind of assets, and these private capital assets, as it's more difficult to access them, they of course present a higher degree of profitability. But of course, to enter this investment, it's difficult to do it, say, on your own, but you need to invest via a fund. Then there is probably also another point is that in my example, to make things easier, I was talking, okay, it's investor as me, you, but in most cases, the investors in these private capital funds are institutional investors or high net worth individual, but in most cases, institutional investors. An example, insurance companies, pension funds. So they are investors that can afford to put a part of their investments in illiquid assets. Because of course, if you invest, if an investment, so a pension funds invest in listed bonds and listed shares, then okay, if this investor needs liquidity, they can immediately sell them. And okay, maybe sell it at a loss, but this is another case. But it's, they are liquid assets, so they're easy to be sold. On the contrary, if an investor put money in this kind of private capital fund, usually the money is blocked there for some years, several years. So it's a kind of investor that has a long-term liabilities, as the case of a pension funds. But because of this, it can afford putting money in a fund that is keeping them for years, but is giving a longer term return, higher return in the long term. So does it answer a bit your question?
Yeah, thank you very
much. So okay, more questions from students, from colleagues, Julia? Yeah, sure. Mikhail, thank you very much for your presentation, very insightful, and I promise you will discuss many of these issues with the students in detail in Russian later on. Thank you just for giving the food for discussion. I have a few questions to you. One question about risks. If you try to map risks for private investment funds, would that map be any different from the map that public investment funds would have? And has it evolved? I assume it has, and which direction has it evolved for private investment funds? And another question is about technological disruptions. How do you perceive them, and do you see them as, another risk or opportunity or alternative to your business? Well, distributive ledger technologies, what do you do with them? Do you adopt them, or do you try to somehow resist the introduction? Well, that's it for this.
Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot. They are both very interesting. I would say regarding the risk, the main difference between say liquid and illiquid funds, so between funds investing in private capital and other funds, is in my view only a liquidity risk, in the sense that for sure the investment in private capital funds is less liquid than investment in shares or bonds, which means of course that it's the example that we were doing before. If I have an investment in shares or bonds listed, I can sell it in a few seconds. On the contrary, if I have an investment in a 200 million building, of course it takes more time to sell it, to dispose of it, and then there are a lot of transaction costs. So the biggest difference in terms, I would say, of risk profile between these two kinds of investment of funds is really regarding liquidity. So investors that need to stay liquid probably would not consider as the best option investing in private capital funds. For the other kind of risk, which are probably those that you are have more in mind, like the insolvency risk, the risk of having a loss, etc. I don't see a big difference between between private capital funds on one side and funds investing in bonds and shares on the other, because all that matters is really the kind of strategy that each of them follows. For instance, let's suppose the case of a private debt fund as an alternative investing in listed bonds. Ultimately, the risk of insolvency, of not having the investment back, depends on the quality of the borrower. So a private debt fund that invests in senior loans granted to strong borrowers, it's in principle safer. It's in principle less risky than investing in bonds issued in junior bonds issued by low quality borrower. So this is really a different, it really matters the investment strategy and the kind of assets that are targeted. And just to provide another example, let's consider the case of investment funds, real estate funds. Again, their risk profile can be very difficult, very different depending on their investment strategy. Because, for instance, in the past, I worked quite a lot on real estate funds that were adopting core strategies and they were investing in commercial real estate. So offices to let. For instance, these funds were investing mainly in, so they were purchasing a building in the center of a few cities like Munich, Amsterdam, Milan, Paris, Berlin, and high quality building in central areas, business districts. So in this case, the risk profile was quite low. Okay, now with the pandemic, the lockdown, this has changed, but this was really an event that changed entirely the system. But normally, this kind of investment in real estate is perceived as quite low risk. On the contrary, another real estate investment fund may, on the contrary, invest in building located in the periphery of cities in developing countries or emerging economies. Of course, this is riskier. So this means that if their investment analysts were good enough to spot the good city, for instance, in Africa, the good neighborhood, which would have increased in price a lot, then the return could have been higher because probably they would have bought something for nothing or almost, and then after 10 years, they can sell it for a lot of money. But of course, the risk is higher because of course, then there is the risk that they will not find the tenant or the tenant will not pay or the building gets destroyed in a local mob or in a terrorist attack. So that's why I would say the level of risk is more related on the specific strategy of the fund, irrespective of whether it is a private capital or a fund investing in listed shares. And regarding your second point, is particularly a topical argument now, the technology disruption. Yeah, it's true that first we have indeed a lot of technology innovation, etc. And on the other side, we have, especially in Europe, but also in the US, an increasing amount of regulatory requirements and reporting requirements. And these essentially consist in the need for the fund to gather a lot of information about the investors, about the investment, and to make every kind of reporting to tax authorities, to investors, to other parties. And indeed, the best way to cope with this is to have a strong automation, strong IT system. So I would say that digital innovation, technological disruption is very helpful to cope with the increasing regulatory request and increasing demand for reporting, exchange of information, etc. So I would say some reporting some sharing of information, etc., is made increasingly possible thanks to the increased digital and technological capability. And so this is probably a very important point. And if we recall what I was saying before about the importance of outsourcing to an administrator, indeed, many fund managers are relatively small structures who want to focus on investment activity. And so they increasingly need to outsource all the administration part of the fund and of the underlying structure to these administrators, who are those who can develop more specific technology to be able to process all the fund operation, reporting needs, etc., in the most efficient way. So I would say technology disruption, in my view, has an impact for private capital funds in this way. Then we can also discuss whether it is impacting a lot the activity of investing, so choosing which investment and on marketing. On this point of view, I think less. So technology disruption is playing a very key role for instance, investment in securities, because sometimes the fastest, you know, the algorithm that process to purchase and to sell a security, the best is the result of the deal. But in this case, as we are talking about private assets, usually it's still a lot relation driven. So at the end, it's important that the fund manager has the ability to meet the right person who sell a certain share in a certain company or a certain building. So from this point of view, I don't see technology disruption really impacting a lot on the investment and marketing point of view. On the contrary, on operation, it's really important, yeah.
Thanks. So thank you. I think that we are coming to the end of our meeting. And let me ask just a short question. In fact, as you mentioned, that the most concentrated, the activity of private capital funds are in US and Luxembourg regions. So what about European Union in general? And let me specify the question. Are there any special European Union programs to boost the investment in private capital funds?
Yeah, indeed. It's on the top of the EU agenda because indeed the EU as an institution has clear in mind that investment funds, especially private capital funds, they are very useful to mobilize capital that can be useful also for the growth. So the European Union has developed a single, or at least an harmonized legal framework governing investment funds. So technically, all investment funds in the European Union are subject to similar rules, not the same rules, because then the directive of the European Union needs to be implemented in each European member state. So some differences applies, but I would say that there are harmonized rules and at the European level, and also there are very good things like the EU passport, which means that essentially if an investment fund is based, is incorporated, set up in one European country, it can sell its units, so it can be marketed to investors in all European countries with a very light procedure. So for instance, Luxembourg investment fund, if it wants to receive the money from investors in Italy, Germany, France, and Spain, does not need to ask the authorization to the authority of all of these countries. No, it's sufficient that it goes to the authority of Luxembourg and it obtains an authorization to market in all of these other European countries. So this is made based on the principle of mutual reliance, mutual recognition, and this is really, really helpful because, of course, the fund will have to ask it to just one national authority. And this is made possible because the overall legal framework is very well harmonized at European level. So this is quite key. And in the US, of course, there are quite harmonized rules also. And then a key point is indeed that the fact that there are a lot of funds in the country does not mean at all that these funds are investing in this country. So this means, for instance, that a lot of investment funds that are based in Luxembourg do not invest in Luxembourg. They invest everywhere, and everywhere in Europe, everywhere outside the world. So essentially, we really see in a certain financial center like US, Cayman Island, Luxembourg, a lot of money coming from investors from all the world. All this money is arriving to the fund and then going away immediately to the various investments in different parts of the world.
Mm-hmm. So thank you very much.
Thanks.
So the lecture almost over. So many thanks, Michele, for very interesting, extremely interesting material, extremely interesting lecture and examples. So we will be very grateful to see you again in our university online or offline. Using the opportunity, I would like to invite you on behalf of our university to take part in our annual conference that take place in May. Yes. So maybe so no questions from the audience. So if no questions, so thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And so we would like to say goodbye, and we'll be very happy to meet you again.
Thanks a lot. Спасибо большое. До свидания.
До свидания.
Bye. Bye.